It takes a lot of work to get that base of donors up and running, but once you really build relationships with them, those are going to be some of your most loyal folks.
I'm Rich Frazier.
And I'm Russ Fanoff.
Welcome to the Nonprofit Fundraising Exchange, a podcast from IPM Advancement.
We believe strong nonprofits can change the world, and our goal with each episode is to bring you insightful conversations with thought leaders from the nonprofit sector.
Let's dive in. Welcome, listeners, to another episode of the Nonprofit Fundraising Exchange. Russ, good to see you again, my friend.
Good to see you, Rich.
Today, we're talking about peer-to-peer fundraising, or P2P, as it's sometimes called. Now, P2P fundraising, that allows individuals to create their own fundraising campaigns on behalf of nonprofit organizations. Then they reach out to their personal networks for donations. This can include fundraising events, social media campaigns, and personal fundraising pages.
Yeah, Rich, peer-to-peer fundraising became popular in the 70s with charity walks and charity runs, where participants sought out sponsorships from friends and family to support their cause. And since then, P2P fundraising has evolved to include online platforms, social media, and other digital tools to expand reach and impact, and a lot of organizations are using it.
And it's got a lot of advantages for nonprofits, like increased visibility to reach, better donor engagement, and more personal connections, and even more funds raised. And for some organizations, P2P can account for anywhere from 10 to 50% of their total fundraising revenue. Mm. Our guests today are no newcomers to NPFX. You may remember them from our episode last season on Giving Tuesday. Some of our favorite people back again, Sadé Dozan and Sarah Murry. Can you please introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about your backgrounds with peer-to-peer fundraising? Sadé, let's start with you.
Hi, I'm so happy to be here again. I'm Sadé Dozan. I use she, her pronouns. I am the Chief of Development and Operations at Caring Across Generations, and I am a longtime fundraiser. I'm a full-time fundraiser, and I've been doing this for well over a decade now, almost two, but not to date myself.
Nobody's counting.
Yeah. And focusing a lot on individual giving, and that includes micro gifts and peer-to-peer. So I'm really excited to dig in.
Thank you, Sadé. Sarah Murry.
Hi, yes. Thank you for having me back. I'm excited to get the gang back together. I've been in fundraising for, I don't know if I should age myself either, for about 16 years now. And I'm the peer-to-peer side of things has been something that's just been an ever-growing trend. And in the last 6 years at my most recent role, I was very digital heavy, digital fundraising focused, but heavy peer-to-peer management. Mm-hmm. And now I'm consulting with some other organizations that are smaller than the a large national organization I've recently worked for. So my goal is evaluating their digital footprint, their presence, and really trying to see if peer-to-peer is going to change the game for them. So I'm excited to have this conversation and see what we can glean from each other.
Nice. Well, let's launch right into it. I know you're both big fans of peer-to-peer fundraising. So I'll start with possibly the easiest question and one that's very accessible for our listeners. What do you love most about peer-to-peer fundraising?
I think the thing about peer-to-peer fundraising that I love is it gives anyone the ability to make a difference. It just engages people who might not want to make a big gift or don't have the capacity to make a set donation, but they want to do something fun. They want to involve their network, regardless mm-hmm. of their wallet size, mm-hmm. and make an impact and get people involved in what they truly care about.
Sadé?
My favorite thing is probably similar. I think that peer-to-peer fundraising operates as a way, a level of engagement for folks, no matter what level that they may be on or ready to enter. It operates as a point of brand exposure for the nonprofit as well. And as we think about long-term engagement, folks that come in through a peer-to-peer pipeline, the folks that
are coming in because they know someone, they're coming into the organization's ecosystem because they know someone, are more likely to stay a little bit longer. Mm-hmm. They feel like they build like an authentic relationship. So I kind of, that's the reason why I like peer-to-peer.
As someone who's, you know, had a long history in annual fund in the trenches, peer-to-peer is kind of a new thing for me. I'll say that. I've been in fundraising now for about 25 years. And it's only in the last 5 or 10 years that I've realized that P2P can be really, really powerful as just a way to generate brand evangelists, right? You get people involved in the organization who might not otherwise have that connection. And then, you know, if you can have a really good stewardship experience and a good donor experience with those people, it seems like that's what's going to keep them coming back. It doesn't necessarily have to be that personal connection to the original primary donor. Maybe you can get people to come back again and again just because you deliver that really good donor experience. Is that something that you've seen, or do people tend to just kind of drop off after their primary contact steps away?
I think it really depends on the organization's follow-up and engagement post the initial donation. So like you have someone that comes in to you via P2P, and then what do you do after? What's the engagement ladder after?
Yeah.
And that is what I see impact retention the most.
So you really want to have a roadmap for people once they get on board. You don't want to just say, oh, well, this is great. We've got all these people coming on board. Thank goodness for that primary donor who brought them all in.
No, you want to maintain a relationship with folks afterwards. Yeah.
Nice.
I'm curious about the, you know, we talk about the benefits of P2P for nonprofit. What are the benefits for donors?
I think one of the biggest benefits for donors is that they get to experience something different and they get to make a peer-to-peer campaign their own. So it's fun for them. They can involve a number of different people. They can tell their story and then they can send it out to other people who maybe didn't understand something that they were going through or who they support. So when a donor gets to create something on their own, they have buy-in to the organization and they feel like they're more part of the whole mission and the impact that it's making as a whole.
Yeah, I would say even a specific aspect of that I've seen that donors have really reflected on as being positive has been literally seeing their engagement, like seeing their impact in a way where like they see the tree. So they're like, I brought in two people and those two people brought in one more. And they're kind of like, I made this happen. And I think that the feeling of investment and working alongside the nonprofit is also what's been really powerful for donors.
Yeah.
People get excited and they're so proud to have done something on their own and really that's impactful. I love what you said. I think that's perfect.
Can we talk a little bit about how that engagement looks in terms of how the donor's relationship to the cause kind of changes by becoming this kind of leadership figure in fundraising? How does that feeling of maybe empowerment and impact really drive the engagement with that primary donor? And I keep calling it primary donor. I don't know if that's the right terminology, but just to separate out that initial kind of person who's driving things to their network.
What I see is that donors who participate in P2P campaigns typically participate multiple times a year in fundraising in general.
Okay.
They're also the folks that are going to volunteer when you need a moment. They're the people that are going to be called to action. Mm-hmm. So for the organization, you have a base of folks that become your stakeholder, become your champions.
Yeah.
And then for the donor, it again builds that sense of community and belonging within the nonprofit that helps as a reflection to further the mission.
Okay. And Sarah?
I think that, you know, just like what Sade said, you have these champions and you have people who are doing things, you know, again, maybe once a year, or then they do it around celebrations and holidays and those sort of things where they feel like they're doing really great things for the organization and they're buying in and they're becoming a part of the family. And it's a good pipeline for us as fundraisers too, because we see the people who want to do something, want to do more. And thankfully we are getting some of their network and some of their donors in, so we can cultivate them and bring them into our mission, a mission that's really important to their friends, family, or what have you.
I think also, as I kind of reflect on the question a little bit more, I think what peer-to-peer fundraising does, and I think Sarah touched on this earlier, there's a level of access involved too. Like usually with peer-to-peer donors, you get a more diverse set of donors that are engaging with the nonprofit than if you were to do like more a traditional giving program. Mm. So you get folks that are like college age, you get folks that are like ethnically diverse, you get like really just all across the spectrum. And I think that that is really, really valuable. And you think about like the impacts that it also has on like your social media presence as well. So I think there's a bunch of different ways that this is like mutually beneficial.
Yeah. And you know, we're also, especially with the pandemic, so many people wanted to do things and a peer-to-peer page was kind of the way to get them in.
Yeah.
And especially when, you know, it's the new age lemonade stand. You know, you can get young kids in who want to celebrate something, they want to do something, and we can engage them as well. And, you know, it starts young. Fundraising for me started when I was going to the food bank with my aunt and stuffing brown paper bags and doing all that. And now we engage kids virtually, and that is exactly where they live these days.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's the beauty of peer-to-peer, is that you can make it look like whatever you want it to look like, right?
Absolutely. You get to make it your own.
So what are some of the challenges that you've experienced running these peer-to-peer fundraising campaigns? And I think just to kind of start the conversation, let's talk first about resources, because to me, that phrase peer-to-peer fundraising just conjures up a ton of work that needs to be done just in terms of structure and organizing it and managing those people. Where do you even start with some of these challenges?
Yeah, I'll start because I'm always thinking about resources. I'm like, there's the resources where it's the literal money, right? The platform that you're going to use that enables folks to actually get involved in these campaigns. Like, you know, like, are you going to use class? Are you going to use every action? Like, what are the ways that you're setting up the platform and the tool? And that can be pretty costly. And then there's also the resources of staff time as well. Like,
yeah.
You need to have, in order for peer-to-peer campaigns to be really successful, you have to have a solid base of those initial fundraisers that are coming from your like core donor base. And that means a lot of outreach, a lot of check-ins, a lot of like, hey, like, let's get started and generating that level of buy-in, which is pretty intense on the staff capacity side. So I'd say that, you know, the tool funding and the staff capacity are two major resource pools.
Do you find a lot of people internally in the organization kind of pushing back? What do you think is maybe a barrier internally when you're trying to get the, you know, your fellow staff on board?
Yeah, I do think the buy-in of your team is the most important, because as fundraisers, if digital isn't something you're really familiar with, or if peer-to-peer isn't something you're completely familiar with, you're a little hesitant because you know your world is asking for a gift, going out and speaking to someone directly. So
yeah,
for me, it's oftentimes been the buy-in from, you know, some of my team, and coaching them and teaching them and really showing results and success is what will take them to that, okay, I'm open to this, I'm ready to do it, because I've seen it work really well.
And I imagine that even in a small program, you really just can't take absolutely everything on as one person, right? You're going to need a team of people around you to support you and help with this.
Absolutely. And that's something that I think every organization learns as they go, because there are so many people who are coming on and they want to do things, but there is a stewardship map that really has to happen and a cultivation throughout the whole process. We have to be their cheerleaders, truly have to be a cheerleader for them. And one of the big things we've tried to push is communication. Like, it's okay to send emails. It's okay to do all of these things, but some people are nervous that it's not the right touch or it's too much communication. So really preparing and planning how you want to run your campaign or how you want to run your whole peer-to-peer program. It's the preparation and really understanding your donors and how to communicate with them effectively.
Yeah, I found that toolkits for donors, which again, thinking about the resources that you have to develop that, but providing those initial fundraisers with those P2P fundraisers with toolkits so that they have things that they can copy and paste and collateral, those are really important for the success of bolstering their confidence, and then also ensuring there's like a level of brand consistency with the outreach. Mm-hmm. But that's also something that, again, is a barrier. If you don't have staff internally that are able to provide those things, it can be really difficult to maintain a level of success with engagement.
Yeah, and I want to piggyback off that because that's a perfect point, is the toolkits I love is putting everything in their hands. One mistake, I believe, not mistake, an opportunity I wish I would have been better about is updating the toolkits and not sending the same thing out to a donor year over year. If we've had someone who did something in 2021 and we send that same toolkit with the same ideas, that's something I oftentimes could kick myself over. But just like everything else, it's a refresher for and maybe it's a tiered structure of how the toolkits go out, but absolutely number one, especially because of the brand. You're putting all of this information into their hands, exactly how they can post on social, email, and it fits exactly what you as your organization would like them to put out there.
Hi, this is Curtis Schmidt, producer of the Nonprofit Fundraising Exchange. If you're a nonprofit professional who has questions about your program, or maybe you feel like you've taken your advocacy, fundraising, or membership effort as far as you can and you need some fresh ideas, then we have a special offer for you today. NPFX podcast listeners can get a free 30-minute consultation with IPM Advancement, no strings attached, when you go to ipmadvancement.com/free. Just enter a few details and an IPM team member will contact you to follow up. It's that easy. That website again is ipmadvancement.com/free. Thanks for listening, and we hope to talk to you soon. Now let's return to the episode.
So there's a lot of competition for the donor dollar out there. How do you time your P2P events so that you're not competing with other organizations or so that you're maximizing participation?
That's the million-dollar question, quite literally, because there are so many things going on. And depending if you're doing something locally or nationally or however big or small you want to go, there's so much going on. Everyone is doing something out there. So again, that's such a tough question to answer, but I think ultimately, really continuing to evaluate what's going on in your market and pushing a really great campaign, something that sets you apart from what other organizations are doing. I think that's often helpful and makes it exciting for people to want to be a part of.
I also think about stewardship throughout the year. My answer is always, what are the seven things that you're saying to them before you ask them to get involved in a P2P? I'm always thinking about long-term touch points and engagement. Mm. What are the things that they've seen from us? Have they gotten collateral before they get asked to be a P2P fundraiser? It's really about the full engagement throughout the year.
Yeah.
So that way, when you do have a big ask, like do a full fundraising campaign with us, it feels like it's part of the trajectory, the natural trajectory.
And that's such a great answer too, because it is that long-term relationship, and that's really how you keep your donors inspired and passionate about your mission. So I'm curious where the two of you think P2P fundraising is headed. How do you think that peer-to-peer is evolving, and how do we stay ahead of the curve given the technologies that are available to us? Are we going to stay on Zoom? Are we going to see more of that over the next few years or forever? Where are we headed? What's the future look like for peer-to-peer?
My answer is I have the easy answer of hybrid. I feel like it's just going to be hybrid. But we have integrated, fundraising has become so integrated with digital tools that I don't think that we will be able to separate. But there's nothing like an in-person auction, an in-person fundraiser. There's nothing like being in person. So I feel like it has to be a blend of both, a blend of in-person events as well as kind of digital community spaces in order for it to be successful. Mm. So my answer is hybrid, which is not an answer.
I think it's a great answer because it's truly where the world is going, especially when we think about hybrid work, mm-hmm. a hybrid school for some, some children and families. But I think I peer-to-peer is here to stay. It's just evaluating what we can do with it as individual organizations and how we can continue to move it along. You know, I've seen different organizations, like Classy is one that I've worked with a lot, and they created Classy Live, which integrates the peer-to-peer side of fundraising and then streaming live events and getting that participation from folks who might not be able to be somewhere in person. So I see a lot of that, like other peer-to-peer platforms, maybe moving to that model where it's kind of a one-stop shop for peer-to-peer fundraising, but engaging people who can't make it to that in-person event.
Just to follow up on that, are there specific technologies or tools that you like to use or that you see donors preferring to use?
Yes, donors like things that are easy and simple. So like if you're asking folks to set up a page, it has to be the simplest thing. Like they press one button and it auto-populates for them. Mm-hmm. So I have seen things like Classy do that really well. Every action has a pretty interface, but you have to do a lot on the back end to make sure that happens. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of like, who are you putting the onus on? And if I had to lean towards putting the onus on anyone, it'd be on the staff and on the nonprofit to make sure that it's the easiest for the donor.
Yeah.
So I lean towards tools that do that.
For sure. And you know, if you have any hiccup when you're trying to make a donation there, I say this personally too, then we don't want it to be off-putting. We don't want you to hop off the page, but I think ease of access and ease of use. And I love all the new integrations with PayPal, Venmo, you know, crypto, all of these different things that the organizations who are with these peer-to-peer platforms, they're essentially making it as easy as possible for donors to do that one-click transaction. So yeah, ease is number one for sure.
Nice. What do you want to see technology do better?
I would like to see better integrations for social media. Mm. So like typically right now, the way we have it is like, you know, like Facebook, like rules the way that the fundraising on Facebook works is not the most seamless way to operate a fundraiser. But I would like for there to be the tools to integrate outside of just share that you donated. I think that there are ways to kind of think through like embedding into platforms and really taking advantage of like the digital space in a way that feels seamless. And it doesn't quite do that just yet. Like folks are, you can share out and you can copy links, but they're not really talking to each other.
That's a great point. And I see that too. People want to have that one click to share as easily as they have that one click to donate. And in a perfect world, what I would love to see are these smaller organizations, maybe grassroots, maybe startups who are doing these big things, but have easier access and more affordable platforms that they can use or they can test. Because oftentimes it's quite costly to bring in a whole new platform, but I would love to see companies that are helping these smaller nonprofits and giving them easier access to training, to the tools, and to launching it for them so they can get in there and they can capitalize on the peer-to-peer side and on these easier entrees into giving. But it's costly. And that's really what I think some organizations where they stop because they're like, okay, it's tough for me to look at this because it's going to be X amount of money.
Yeah, there's definitely an accessibility part to this for smaller nonprofits, right? There's all those resources that we talked about, that commitment you really have to make in getting everybody on board. And you know, it represents a huge opportunity for small nonprofits, but they have to be able to manage it because if someone has a bad experience in that campaign, they might not come back as a donor. So it's really important to get it right.
Absolutely.
Well, this has been an excellent conversation, and I'm sure our listeners have learned a lot about peer-to-peer fundraising if they didn't know already. It's almost time for us to go, but let's talk about takeaways. So if listeners could take away one thing from this episode about peer-to-peer fundraising, even if it's something we haven't talked about yet, what would you like that to be? What do you want people to take away? Sadé, let's start with you.
It takes a lot of work to get that base of donors up and running, but once you really build relationships with them, it pays off in the long term. Those are going to be some of your most loyal folks.
Nice. And Sarah?
I think number one is to prepare and to plan how you want to jump into that space and telling people why you want to get into that space. And the most important thing is thanking donors, thanking all of the people who start these fundraisers for you, and it being a meaningful thank you.
Interesting. Well, Rich, I think I'm starting to change my view of P2P fundraising from where I previously kind of thought about it as the self-checkout of nonprofit fundraising. I'm starting to think now maybe there's something more to it. Maybe we need to kind of reframe it and focus on that engagement and giving people good experiences. And maybe that's the key.
Well, see, there you go. And you can even have a good experience in the self-checkout line as well.
Well, wait. I have yet to experience that yet.
All right. Sarah, Sade, where can our listeners find out more about you? Sarah, let's start with you.
I have a LinkedIn account that anyone can check out, Sarah Murry. I'm sure I can share my link with you. I'm always open to having a conversation with anyone who wants to talk about peer-to-peer or anything fundraising. And I truly love what peer-to-peer can do. And I love the reference to the self-checkout. And I think that's great. Like, you got to trademark that, because that's a really good way to say it again, because people might be afraid or they might not know what it's all about. But as a fundraiser and hearing this, this is something that it's a takeaway for me, because when I build the next peer-to-peer platform, or when I build that next campaign, or whatever that might be, I have to understand that there might be fear among the donors because they don't know if it's going to work and they don't know what's going to happen. And they're afraid sometimes to ask their friends or network. So it's.
Oh, Sarah, we lost you just on that last point.
Oh man, I had such a good point. I was saying it's about getting rid of the fear and making it fun for them.
Excellent.
Sade, where can we find out more about you?
I'm also on LinkedIn. I think that that's a great place to connect. And also, like, you know, if you want to take a look at caringacross.org, that's the organization I'm with, you can always check out what we're doing and the way that we engage our audience and find me.
Awesome.
Sade Dozan and Sarah Murry, thank you for joining us today. We'll have Sade and Sarah back in 2 weeks for a discussion about how to get started with P2P fundraising. And I'm really looking forward to hearing your thoughts about that. We want to thank our producer, Curtis Schmidt, as always. Russ, as Luther would say, it's never too much. And to our listeners, thank you for joining us. We'll see you next time on the Nonprofit Fundraising Exchange.
Thanks for listening. Bye-bye.
That concludes this episode of the Nonprofit Fundraising Exchange. Thanks to our panel for sharing their insights and expertise. If you'd like to learn more about our panel members or any of the organizations or resources featured in this episode, we will include links in the show notes. If you like this podcast, we would love your help spreading the word. First, please subscribe in Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Google Podcasts, or your favorite podcast app, so you always know when a new episode is released. Second, forward the episodes you like to friends and colleagues, or share them on social media. Word of mouth is one of the best ways you can help us reach more nonprofit professionals like yourself. And if you use Apple Podcasts or Audible, please leave us a review. Positive reviews are how many listeners decide whether or not to try out a new podcast. We appreciate your help. For suggestions on topics, guests, or nonprofit organizations you'd like to hear on the podcast, send an email with the subject heading NPFX suggestion to contact@ipmadvancement.com. For back episodes and more resources like white papers, infographics, and blog articles, please visit the free IPM Advancement Nonprofit Resource Library at ipmadvancement.com/resources. Thanks for listening, and we'll see you next time.